Chapter 14 of Beleriand and its Realms. Now, this chapter takes a break from the action and the plot in order to give you a more detailed understanding of where everyone settles down and what the lands look like. So here we go. Morgoth rules the north from the Iron Mountains. He made those mountains way back when he built his old fortress of Utumno, and we know that his current fortress, Angband, lies to the west of the ruins of Utumno. So Angband is actually a vast network of dungeons that lie beneath the mountains, and it's connected to a tunnel that opens out at its front gates under the three mountains Thangorodrim. And even though Morgoth caused the plain of Ardgalin to be desolate, it still manages to have green grass, which is kind of nice. To the west is Heathloom, which we saw in the last chapter. The Quenya name for it is Hisilome, and it's a very cool, misty land with cold winters, although it is beautiful. And this is where Fingolfin and his oldest son, Fingon, live. Fingolfin and his people dwell mostly in Mithrim, around the shores of the lake. Fingon is assigned Dor Lomin, but their main fortress that they keep watch from is Aethel Sirion. That's where the Sirion River starts, and that's on the eastern side of the Mountains of Shadow. And they let their horses kind of graze out on the plain. To the west of that, is Nevrast, the hither shore, which is Turgon's realm. Turgon is Fingolfin's second son, if you recall. And this land has a milder climate than Heathloom, with lots of moisture from the sea and shelter from the Ered Lomin. The first large mingling of Noldor and Sindar actually happened here, right after the Noldor arrived in Middle-earth. So it's kind of like a melting pot. And Turgon establishes the city Vinyamar on the coast. Vinyamar will be a very important location later on in the book. And south of Ardgalin are the highlands of Dorthonion, where great pine forests grow, and where there are many tarns, or small mountain lakes. Finarfin's third and fourth sons, Angrod and Aignor, occupy the northern part of Dorthonion. They are vassals of their oldest brother, Finrod, and they keep a close watch on the plain during the siege. The southern edge of Dorthonion is where the Ered Gorgoroth are. Remember those mountains of terror where Ungoliant went? That valley below the mountains is called Nandungortheb, and it is a no man's land, and whenever anyone absolutely has to pass through it, they always stick really close to the northern border of Doriath. They do not want to go anywhere near those mountains. It's just not good. Then just west of Dorthonion is a narrow valley, the Vale of Sirion. And in the middle of the river is an island where Finrod builds Minas Tirith, a watchtower. Yes, that's the same name as the Minas Tirith in Gondor in Lord of the Rings, if you recall. But after Finrod moves south and establishes Nargothrond, he puts his younger brother Orodreth in charge of this area. And the River Sirion is the main river in Beleriand. It's really large and really powerful. It passes by the forest of Brethil and through a small part of the realm of Doriath. Then it flows into kind of a flat, marshy area where it spreads out and loses its force. The land gets really flat. And it's in this place where Turgon and Finrod have their dreams from Ulmul, telling them to build mighty fortresses. We saw that in the last chapter. But directly south of that area, the elevation suddenly drops, and the river gathers its full force underground. And then it bursts out, a few miles away, from under the hills, and continues on its way south towards the bay. And right now, people don't really live in this southern area near the river's mouth. A long chain of hills divides the northern and southern portions of Sirion, and the westernmost end of the hills is where Finrod builds Nargothrond. It's located in a deep gorge in the river Narog. But the entire realm of Nargothrond is actually the largest of all the Noldor realms, stretching from the river Nenning all the way to Sirion. But Finrod, of course, doesn't rule the Falas, the coast, because that's Círdan's realm, remember. But of course, those two guys, they get along really well. Finrod's people help Círdan build up the havens of Brithombar and Eglarest, and Círdan's people even teach some of Finrod's people how to make ships. So there you go. Finrod even builds a watchtower on the coast. Although, if you recall, Morgoth hates the sea. So in fact, that watchtower will never be necessary, because Morgoth will never actually attack Beleriand from the sea. Now the other great river is Gellion in the east. It's longer than Sirion, but it's not as powerful. It doesn't have as much volume of water. And as you can see, it has many tributaries flowing down from the Eredluin, the Blue Mountains. And this lovely green country of Osiriand is where the Laikwendi live, if you recall. They love singing so much that the Noldor refer to Osiriand as Lindon, or Land of Music. Finrod eventually travels here, too, and makes friends with the Green Elves. And now let me just take a moment to talk about Finrod. This guy is so cool with everyone. He befriends dwarves, he befriends the Sindar on the coast, the Green Elves. I wonder who else he's gonna make friends with. Speaking of future events in the book, Beren and Lúthien are briefly mentioned here as living on the island of Tol Galen, and Maedhros is mentioned as living on Amon Ereb, quote, after the great defeat, unquote. Don't worry if you have no idea what those sentences mean, because you will read about them later. All of Feanor's people patrol and guard the March of Maedhros, as well as the plain of Lothlan in the north. And most of them actually live kind of around this northeastern area of Beleriand. And of course, speaking of Maedhros, he establishes his citadel on the hill of Himring, which is the tallest hill among many. And it's a cold and somewhat barren place, but it's a good lookout. And between these hills of Himring and Dorthonion is a narrow, very cold and windy pass that Celegorm and Curufin, the third and fifth sons of Feanor, have fortified. And their region of influence is called Himlad, which is kind of like a grassy plain area. Maglor, the second son of Feanor, is in charge of the flat gap where the two upper branches of the river Gellion meet. So that's called Maglor's Gap. And it's here that much of the Noldor cavalry is located. Then east of that, we know it's Caranthir's domain, and it's called Thargelion. And his abode is on Lake Hellevorn. And the youngest of Feanor's sons, the twins, Amrod and Amras, they really seldom come to the north, and their land is just a bit more south. You know, they prefer, I guess, to hunt and go through the woods rather than go on guard. And there you have it, the realms of Beleriand. So let's do a little recap. Of the non-Noldor, you have the Sindar of Doriath, ruled by Melian and Thingol. You have the Falathrim on the coast, the Sindar also, ruled by Círdan. And there's Osiriand, ruled by the Laikwendi, or the Green Elves. And of the great lords of the Noldor, you have the seat of the High King of the Noldor, Fingolfin, in Heathloom, along with his son Fingon. Then Nevrast, ruled by Fingolfin's son Turgon, and Nargothrond, ruled by Finrod, Finarfin's oldest son, and his younger brothers are his vassals, with Orodreth in the Pass of Sirion, and Angrod and Aignor in Dorthonion, and then the Feanorians, Maedhros on top of Himring, Maglor in the Gap, Caranthir in Thargelion, Celegorm and Curufin in Himlad, and Amrod and Amras further south. But just, I'm going to end on a funny note. None of the Noldor in these Elder Days ever go exploring in the lands east of Beleriand. It's kind of funny. They were so eager to come to Middle-earth, and they just kind of stay put in Beleriand and don't bother to go out and explore.